athletes ever.
I think a legitimate argument could be made. She's top two.
Who's the other?
I think, listen. I like to say Michael Jordan because he's undefeated, 6 titles. I know that Bill Russell was obviously a champion. The absence of parity back at that particular moment in time, I just got questions about that, just different age. Maybe I should have a greater appreciation for it. I mean, the man won 11 titles for crying out loud in 13 years. I get that. But Michael being undefeated, 6-0, walking away from the baseball, walking away to play baseball, retiring after his father had passed away, 3-peats on 2 occasions. Legitimate argument could have been made he could have won 8 straight, but also the iconic figure that he was. Magic Johnson, along with Larry Bird, played a pivotal role in opening the floodgates for Black guys like Michael Jordan to go mainstream. If there were no Michael Jordan, there would not have been a LeBron James, per se, in terms of how much of a global iconic figure and brand that he is. But I marvel at Serena Williams. 23 majors, singles majors titles, still chasing Margaret Court, just one short. What she has done in her phenomenal career on the tennis court in and of itself makes her the greatest female tennis player ever, okay? But then when we add to that the adversity that she's had to deal with, being a Black woman, being subjected to the ridicule and the vitriol that her and her family, through her father, some of the things Venus has gone through, some of the things Serena has been said, the things that have been said about her, the way that people have attacked her and what have you, and to have to work through that. And then keep in mind, she also won one title when she was pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
Literally pregnant and won a title.
The Australian Open.
That's right, the Australian Open. So I just look at it from that perspective, and I'm just like, we ain't seen anything like her. I look at her and Ali, and you want to throw Jordan in there, you want to throw Tiger Woods in there because of how he introduced folks to the sport of golf. In other words, he opened the gates for Black folks to be received, even though some would argue that's still a challenge. But Serena, my God, I don't have a problem with her being number one or number two or number three. It don't matter. I mean, Muhammad Ali, Michael Jordan, her, I don't have a problem with it. She's right there.
You got to my number one. You got there eventually. But I agree with you. Serena is in the conversation. You start laying it out. You look at the candidates. You talk about, I think, Tom Brady. You got to include the men's side of this because Roger Federer has been absolutely the greatest tennis player to live, although he's being chased right now by two that might overtake him.
Novak Djokovic and
Rafa Nadal. You got Tiger Woods and Jack Nicklaus in golf. You got Michael Phelps in swimming and Usain Bolt in track and field. But you brought up an interesting word. You said icon. So it's not just about what you've achieved, right? It's not just about your greatness on the field or on the court.
Yes.
It's about what you've meant off it as well. And Serena obviously has meant a world. Whether it be gender, race, dominance, adversity, body type, Serena has broken down barriers at every step. The only person that I can think of who definitively surpasses her as greatest of all time by checking the boxes in the ring and as an icon is Muhammad Ali.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Muhammad Ali's influence and greatness exceeds boxing. It exceeds the American culture. It exceeds everything. And let's not pretend it didn't come with adversity. It didn't come with controversy. It came with everything you could ever ask of an athlete, including self-promotion.
Right.
I think Muhammad Ali has to start and finish as number one.
I don't have a problem with Ali being number one, obviously. But when you talk about, you know, what they embody and what they represent, you know, Black folks talk about what you overcome.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously that would put Ali first and foremost above everybody because of what he went in, how he was stripped of his license to fight, you know, how he was threatened with incarceration, how he was facing 5 years in prison minimum, etc., how he was a pariah and considered unpatriotic and all of these different things that came with it. And that's why, I mean, on my radio show, I stop people that bring up Colin Kaepernick and compare him to Muhammad Ali. There is no comparison. No disrespect to Colin Kaepernick, but there's no comparison there. I don't allow that on my radio show.
You know, truly, Stephen A., it's hard. I wasn't alive during that time.
That's
you
right.
were young during that
right.
time. Muhammad Ali and the culture and environment that he did all of this in, the way the United States was in the 1960s, it's really hard for us to understand. It's really hard
for us. Well, you can say that.
It's abstract, Stephen A. It's historical.
To some degree, but I will tell you this. He was stripped of a championship. Colin Kaepernick didn't have a championship.
Right.
He was prohibited from making money. Not only did Colin Kaepernick make money before kneeling, he made money after with his grievance and his settlement, for crying out loud. There's a plethora of things that you can point to that Ali had to endure, and palpable things that it cost him. That is not necessarily the case with Colin Kaepernick. Sure. Now, I don't mind saying that because I certainly don't want to disrespect or impugn what Colin Kaepernick did by any stretch of the imagination. But I'm not going to allow anybody to compare what he's done, what he's endured, to what Ali endured. It doesn't compare. It doesn't.
The scale is different. And I think your third is worth mentioning again as well. That's Michael Jordan, because his cultural influence is massive.
Yes.
All right, guys, we're going to wrap the conversation up, go to break, and come back. We have more to discuss coming up. Yeah. All right, the 51st U.S. Open continues today on ESPN with more first-round matches at noon Eastern, featuring 15-year-old American Coco Gauff, as well as defending women's champ Naomi Osaka. Then at 7 Eastern, 4 Pacific, it's our primetime coverage highlighted by Rafa Nadal and Sloane Stephens matches. And First Take will be at the Open this Friday at 10 a.m. Eastern.